Hello, I'll talk about hierarchical correlation reconstruction, which is a family of methods to model predict probability distributions. So this is kind of between classical statistics and machine learning. So in classical statistics, we often work on moments. So they provide rough description of our data, but they have nice advantages like interpretability. That the parameters moments are found independently, are unique. We have control of accuracy of the model prediction, but it only provides very rough description of the data. So from the other side, we have machine learning, for example, working with neural networks. So the estimation is much more difficult, usually to some iteration. The interpretability is usually very difficult. There is large dependence between the parameter. Parameters are not unique. There is large freedom often of the model, optimal model, by permuting the parameters, for example. We don't have usually control of the accuracy, but it can go to very accurate description of the data set. So I'll talk about some kind of intermediate approach, which works kind of moments, but they are optimized. So the ordinal cumulants are chosen to be additive, that adding to random variables, we have sum of cumulants like variance. So these moments are no longer additive, but replace it with another advantage, being able to re reconstruct probability distribution. So the idea is very simple, to represent probability distribution as a linear combination of functions. So I use orthonormal family as polynomials. There could be also used some co cosine Fourier basis. So doing so, having this orthonormal family, the estimations turn out, mean square error estimation turns out very simple, that the parameter is just mean of the over the sample of given function. So we have still interpretability, the parameters are found independently modeled. We have uniqueness as mean square error optimization. We have controlled of accuracy, and you have the entire model of the net density, one-dimensional, two-dimensional, up to higher dimensional models. And in theory, you could go to complete description of joint distribution of multiple variables, having infinite sample. So this is so we can, for example, use it for kind of calculation of conditional distributions, like in Bayes. Usually, having model of joint distribution of t variables, we can substitute some of them and normalize, and we get conditional distribution for the remaining variables. So like in Bayes, but without Bayes, having the by having the entire model of joint distribution. So we also talk about non-stationarity for evolving model, that the density evolves in time, missing data, for example. So here is a simple situation. So I will usually, nearly always, I will normalize the variables as in copula theory to nearly uniform distribution. So having each variable uniform distribution, the joint distribution in zeroth approximation is uniform distribution on 0, 1 squared. So this is zeroth approximation of independent normalized variables. Then we add the simplest coefficient 1, 1. This is first orthonormal polynomial times first orthonormal polynomial heat density. So we can see that adding this coefficient as positive, if growing value of one variable, expected value of the second variable also grows. So this is kind of dependence between first moment, expected value of the first variable, and expected value of the second variable as 1, 1. Now we have 1, 2. So going right, we see that the variance grows. So this is dependence between expected value of the first variable and variance of the second variable. So now it's no longer symmetric. So we can also 2, 1. So now in the opposite direction, and 2, 2, dependence between variances. So that if one has large variance, the second has also large variance. So this is called homoscedasticity in economy. And this is very frequent in economy. So we get kind of decomposition of statistical dependencies between here two variables into into mixed moments, which allows us to model the joint distribution of the two variables. Then we can do it hierarchical Cartesian reconstruction into pairs, dependencies between pairs of variables, tuples, and so on. Okay, so let's look at a simple situation, a one-dimensional situation. So we have some sample, the orange points, and the question is from which density, from what density this sample comes from. So we could use zeroth order polynomial, first order polynomial. This is adding information about expected value. So we can see that expected value is toward left here. Then we can add second order polynomial, kind of adding information about variance, about the tail behavior. Then we got skewness, kurtosis, and so on. So intuitively getting better and better model. However, we have also overfitting. So if the we can see that there's a problem in very high degrees, it's degree 30, we can see that sometimes the density, this model density goes below zero. So there is a problem that modeling density as linear combination, can go below zero. I repair it further with calibration. So I call it calibration. So instead of taking such a predicted density, I take maximum of this density at let's say 0.1 or some more sophisticated calibration function. So this is one problem. Sometimes it can go below zero, would need some repairment. Another issue question is which degree of polynomial is the best choice? So the natural answer is through cross-validation, that we separate them the set into training and test or validation set, and check if the model generalizes that, if in validation it improves the propagation. I usually use log likelihood evaluation if it improves in cross-validation. So here the best is fourth, then we have some overfitting. Here is a simple derivation of the formula of this estimation that we should just take a mean over the data set of the function. So the derivation is very simple, that we take, we have the data set as the blue point here. We do this kernel density estimation, put small Gaussian in each point, and the question is what width of this Gaussian should we choose? Epsilon here is very narrow, here is very, very wide. So having such smooth sample as rho A, G epsilon, this is the smooth sample, you'd like to find coefficients of this linear combination, let's say with polynomials, orthonormal polynomials, such that to minimize this mean square error. this integral unfortunately goes to infinity because of this term. But we are only interested in the coefficients, these A coefficients. So this term does not affect this coefficient. So we can just remove this term and optimize the remaining. And now we can find the coefficients. If assuming orthonormal basis, then we get this very simple formula in the limit epsilon goes to zero. So in fact, we are assuming this epsilon goes to zero. Anyway, otherwise you get a bit smoother coefficient. So it's the best choice going to this epsilon, go to zero, but it requires this trick of removing this term, which okay, it goes to infinity. Okay, here is a simple situation. So some daily log returns for, I think, from Dow Jones time sequence. price. So here we do this normalization as in Copula theory. So we have some values and we approximate probability distribution this value comes from. So it can be, let's say, Gaussian distribution, maybe some more sophisticated parametric distribution, or it could be empirical distribution by just sorting the values and saying which quantile corresponds to a given value. So which position after sorting has this value. So here we have this Gaussian cumulative distribution function. We go through the CDF. So we have y as a non-ordinal variables. Then we go through this cumulative distribution function, and we get x, which is from approximately from uniform distribution. At the end, we can inverse this process, so use inverse CDF to get some prediction for the ordinal probability distribution. So here are some examples. So here are the point, the pairs of these log returns for the two neighboring days. And so in zero approximation, they are from uniform distribution. Yes, but you can see that there are some denser and sparser regions. So here is approximation using these small bases of four polynomials. So we can see that there is some denser, sparser regions. And here is using much larger bases up to degree 9. So now we can see that there is some overfitting, these white regions, which means below zero, it means this calibration. Okay, so here is some approximation. Here is for the Dow Jones 29 companies over 10 years. So here is standard correlation matrix for the log returns daily. And here is this 1-1 coefficient from the methodology I'm talking about. So first normalization, and then fitting this coefficient, this polynomial coefficient. And you can see that this and this is nearly the same. So we can intuitively imagine this 1-1 coefficient as nearly correlation coefficient. But you get much more. So this is 1-1 coefficient, but we can also ask about 1-2 coefficient. So this is no longer symmetric. So now there is some, now it is not the same as 2-1 coefficient. So 2-1 coefficient would be just transposing this matrix. So this asymmetry suggests that maybe you could use it for application like trying to find what causes what, the causality. So this is a very difficult question, but asymmetric dependencies suggest that maybe we could try to do it. So we can see, for example, some columns here suggesting that this company has larger influence on the remaining, on the entire market, in fact. Here is two coefficient. So we can, it's always positive, nearly always positive for economical data. That means that if one has large variance, that the remaining usually also have large variance. And here is using time as another variable, and turn out that it was always negative here for these 10 years. It turned out that it was because it was 10 years after this 2008 crisis. And after the crisis, the correlations grow, and then they relax through these years here. Okay, so what function can we use for this normalization? So I've mentioned Gaussian distribution, but I generally So suggest using more general. For example, here is this generalized normal distribution, also called exponential power distribution. So it's exp to absolute value of the power kappa. So for kappa equal 2, we get Gaussian, but we can, for kappa equal 1, we get Laplace distribution, which is very common, called error function. So in data compression, we always use Laplace distribution. So the big question, what kappa should we choose? And we can ask the data what kappa should we choose by performing MLM, maximum likelihood estimation, finding for which kappa we get the largest evaluation, like log likelihood standard evaluation, which is logarithm of probability of getting the sample from this distribution. So I usually use this family, asking about this kappa, not trying to assume it. Or we can use also heavy-tailed distribution, so where there is stable distribution, which is very nice because it satisfies this generalized central limit theorem that adding variables of infinite variance. So if finite variance, we get Gaussian distribution, but for infinite variance, we get some stable distribution. So it has some universality that adding variables of infinite variance, of any variance, we get one of them, any, because Gaussian distribution is also the also, the student distribution is very popular, and for data, often it turns out giving very good performance. Okay, so I've mentioned that we can use a fixed Kumara distribution function here, but we can also use evolving in time. So, for example, from models like Arch-Garch, we can get a Laplace distribution of varying width. So we could use this varying width. So we get different center and width of Laplace distribution and use this Laplace distribution, Gaussian distribution for this moment to perform the normalization, which is a bit better. I recommend it to do it, do as good normalization as we can, and then try to some further methods like this polynomial modeling. So in contrast to these Gaussian models, I have introduced and recommend this kind of exponential power distribution based model. So for them, estimation of the center of the distribution is not that simple. For two is the mean, for Gaussian is the mean, for one Laplace is median, so it's much more difficult. For general kappa, it's kind of between median and Gaussian and mean, it's more complicated. But so the mu is not that simple to find optimally, but we can usually take median or mean. And having the mu, the width is very simple to estimate. It's just mean of to power kappa. So for Gaussian, we know these formulas for as square root of variance for the standard deviation. But having this simple estimator, we can transform it into kind of evolving estimator. So replace this mean with exponential moving average. So mean kind of assumes that all the values have the same weight, and replacing with exponential moving average, we say that the weights weakening in time. So this is kind of moving estimator that we go to another. So we have time series, we go to another time, and we find the estimator for this time window kind of with weakening weights in the past. So we get. We update the estimator. So here is, for example, such fixed Gaussian distribution, and here is such adaptive Gaussian using this moving estimator. So here is evaluation. So for a standard Gaussian for Dow Jones data 100 year approximately. So for standard Gaussian distribution, local likelihood using Gaussian is very poor. So for Laplace, for using Laplace, that this kappa, this power using one is much better. And for adaptive, it is even better, sure. So we can see some improvement by distributing this kind of evolving width distributions. Also, this maximum is a bit shifted compared to the static model. Also, we could use linear regression, adaptive linear regression model. So in linear regression, we want to optimize the mean square error, but we could use this mean square error, which is weighted exponentially toward the past, and this way we get this moving estimator for the coefficients of this linear regression. Here is some discussion for economical data about this kappa. So here is estimation with maximum likelihood estimation of the kappa for various companies. So here is the name, so we can see that the kappa, optimal kappa, is not 2, it's even below 1. So as assumption that it's 2, it's a very poor assumption that we teach, that people teach economy students that we should use Gaussian distribution, kappa equal 2. So it's very bad. So and what does it mean is bad assumption? It means that the tail is very thin in this assumption kappa equal 2, while if data says kappa equal 1, that means that the tail is much heavier. It's not heavy tail, but heavier than Gaussian tail. For example, here is a nice link that a sigma event should happen once per 10 to 12 years, but for data data it happens every 10 years. So you can see that we greatly, gigantically underestimate extreme events. So please be very careful if using Gaussian distribution, especially for economical data, because in practice it's usually much closer to Laplace distribution. And if you are not certain, I recommend using maximum likelihood estimation and asking what the kappa is from the data instead of assuming it. Okay, so So here are some examples of these polynomial predictions. I often use these vertical lines as the real values. So here is the prediction as the polynomial, and then the vertical line is the real value. So the higher it is, the better prediction. So here is the polynomial. Here is after the calibration, not to go below zero, and here is return to the ordinal density. So so Laplace is without prediction, and the colorful plots are after the prediction, kind of deformed Laplace distribution. See here. So here is also there's important remark here that that this kind of polynomial models I'm talking about can only multiply by polynomial the distribution which was used for the normalization, like Laplace distribution here. So it is crucial to use a good distribution for this normalization, especially the tail behavior cannot be repaired by the further modeling the polynomial. So choose the tail behavior, the normalizing distribution, especially to get good behavior for the tails. The rest can be improved at least with the polynomial models I will talk about. So here is for three-dimensional case. It's very similar. The basis for two variables was product basis, that we multiply them, the polynomial. So here are the orthonormal polynomials. So zeroth polynomial is constant. First, it's kind of adding this linear term, second order, third order, and so on. It's kind of adding expected volume, variance, skewness, kurtosis. So we use product basis. We want to represent density as our combination of this using this product basis. So then a basic estimation is just taking mean over the data set of this function. So we can also do more sophisticated estimation. For example, for the missing data, we could use so here is such simple single coefficient. So in some high dimension, you have coefficient which many zeros. So zeros means that here is you use this fixed this constant function. So there is no dependence. In this coefficient, there is no dependence over the variables marked with zeros, only between the non-zero variables. So this coefficient would describe only variance. It depends between variances of this variable, fifth variable, and sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth variable. So this way we can get kind of this hierarchical correlation reconstruction that we have many variables and we have coefficients which describe marginal distribution of each variable, then pairwise dependencies, then triplewise dependencies, and so on between variables. So we can add this additional higher order dependencies between variables, but we can see that there is a problem with the number of coefficients. So for two, it grows with the second power of number of variables, for three, third power, and so on. So it's very important and difficult to properly choose the basis here. So usually done by this cross-validation, that we split the data into training and validation data set and check if evaluation improves in the validation set. Okay, so another way for estimation is replacing this mean. Okay, is this missing data that to calculate this coefficient with 2, 2, if having missing data that they don't have all the values in this row, we don't care if there is missing this value, this or this value or this value. We only need this and this value to estimate this coefficient. So we can effectively use missing data that to calculate this coefficient, estimate this coefficient. We can use all the rows which have these two values. We don't care about the rest of the values. Another possibility is this non-stationarity. So replacing this estimator with average, with exponential average. And this way we get evolution of model of the mixed moments of the density. Okay, so let me skip it. So here is such some evaluation and comparison with Kennedy city estimation. So here we have the points I have shown some before. And the question is, what is this density? So we could use Kennedy density estimation. It's a very classical model that you could just put Gaussian in each point. So here is such Kennedy density estimation densities for values width of this Laplace as spherically symmetric. So the question is, which is the best one? So we should use this cross-validation that we separately have training and test set. And doing so, we get this plot depending on the on this radius. And so so it can barely go above zero. And zero we get for just assuming rho equal one. So for rho equal one, we get log likelihood zero. So without any model, we get zero. So this model can barely get above this baseline. So it's very poor. It does not generalize. It just says that the new points will be close to the old points. In contrast, here is this model using polynomials or some cosines. And we can see that it can handle. It depends on the degree. The best choice is here, degree four. So it's this density. So why it didn't generalize? It says that the new points will be close to the old points. This one generalizes. It asks for the moments, and from these moments model the density. So it's much better. So KDE is good for one dimension, but for high dimension is very poor model. This behaves much better. Okay, so maybe let me skip it. So here is some comparison with Coppola theory. So in economy they use also this normalization to nearly uniform, and then have some families of this one parameter, maybe two parameter function, and then try to fit the parameter and evaluate and choose the best one. In contrast, here we can do some kind of Taylor expansion and ask if we are improving the model or not by cross-validation, and take the model which gives the best evaluation cross-validation, like here. And so here is kind of data agnostic. We don't need to know that the data is of given type, but just do kind of Taylor expansion and cut it when the performance the best, the generalization is the best. So if the data is from one of these distributions, you should use the standard distribution. But if it's more complex data, this can be much better. And here's one parameter models, and here is many parameters model, as many as we need. We take the best we can find. Okay, let me go to some articles with applications. Here is application for prediction of bid-ask spread between them, these prices for buying and selling, then what is the gap between them. We try to predict them, this one variable from three variables, so price, volume, and high minus low price of the company. So it was for some German and Austrian market companies. And it's published here. So the model I'm talking about will predict probability distribution for this bid-ask spread, but to compare it with for value, we can use this probability distribution and take expected value as the simplest prediction of value from probability distribution. And here is some comparison. So here are normalized values. There are some two standard formulas, AMI, Hallerer. So here is the prediction from this formula. Here is the real value. So a perpendicular would have diagonal here. You can see it's not diagonal. It's noise practically. So the standard models work terrible here. But the models that we talk about can work well, but they are very large models and maybe a bit overfitted. That they was used. There was cross validation. But okay. So there are 400 parameter models here. So here you can see there are great models. So here is one common model for all the companies. I would like to take one model. Here are two models. So there is made some kind of clustering of companies having similar models. And here are individual models for each company. So it's definitely the best. And some additional variable, using some additional variable. So we can see that it can handle it. There are much larger models, like 400s of parameters. So here is evaluation of prediction of value as expected value. So we can see that it avoids the extreme values because probability distribution, I think expected value iteratively will not be some extreme value. So you have more. We have the probability distribution. So we can do more. For example, you could find quanta, some you have uncertainty of the prediction. Could make some Monte Carlo. We could perform some further functions of this prediction because just having expected value, let's say, some if the further function is not linear, then we cannot just use expected value. You should have the direct probability distribution, and here we can do it. but just predicting expected value, we cannot do it. Okay, so. Here is such simple model. So we predict 8 moments based on mixed moments of the 3 variables. So the 3 variables were price, volume, high, and slow, and we predict one variable bit minus ask. So the model here is a bit different than what I have shown before, because this model prediction joint distribution works well for low dimension. For high dimension, I usually do this kind of that. I say that conditional distribution of y under condition x is a linear combination of these polynomials as previously, but now the coefficient depends on the context. So x, the context here are the 3 variables. So I would like to make some model here is linear combination, could be used some more complex like neural networks. So here is the model. Linear combination is nice for, let's say, for example, for interpretability. So here is the, so the greens are the coefficient is nearly zero. And so here we predict the first moment, the F1. And we can see that F1, the main contribution positive is from 0, 0, 1. So the 0, 0, 1, the last variable is high minus or low. So it means that if the high minus, so the, there is, if high minus low grows, then bit ask spread increases if it's the, so there is correlation between them. Then there is, so second was volume. So now we see negative correlation. So if volume grows, the bit ask spread decreases. And there is some weaker for the price. And we have also more complicated dependencies. So for example, this that variance is affected by this correlation between second and third variable. So this is much more complex dependence, and it is clearly seen in this data. Also, this very much more complex. Here are examples of such predictions. So so there are 10 examples of predicted polynomials after normalization here, and the r-value is the vertical line. So predict some density and then look at the real value. If you have some big peak and the real value is the center of this peak, then it's great prediction. So to evaluate the prediction, I thought take this real value. This predicted density in the real value. So taking mean of logarithm of such something like this, we get log likelihood, but real we can just sort them. And so we have sorted values. What is the so we have using the condition, using the context, this context, the model predicts some density, and we ask what is the value of this density for the real value, and we sort them. So the higher it is, the better prediction. And taking logarithm and taking average, we get log likelihood. So it is kind of a bit better prediction than just like it does take about average, and it shows how it behaves over the data set. And the colors here show the 10 experiments as in cross validation, in tenfold cross validation, that I take 1/10 as a validation set and the remaining as training set. So to see if there is large difference, we can see that there is not a large difference here. Okay, and here are nice evaluations of the variables. So we have three variables, and the question is how much information is given by each variable. So we can do the evaluation here as using likelihood. We can have each has information theory interpretation as conditional entropy. So we have kind of bits of information. So how many new bits of information is provided by this additional variable? So here are the three colors for using single variable for prediction, then using pairs of variables, then using all three. And we can see that every time increasing the number of variables, the predictions a bit improves. So this difference can be seen as conditional entropy. How many new bits of information is provided by this new variable? Okay, so here are the models. So here was the common model for all I have mentioned. Here are these two clusterings of companies I'm showing in a moment. So what we can see that this one cluster and the second cluster, the main difference is here, that this blue dot, which means that if there is price dependence for the beta spread, so we can see that in this cluster there is no dependence, and in this cluster there is strong dependence. So we can see this subtle differences between the companies, that this subset of companies has no dependence for beta spread from price, and this one has. This automatic observation from this kind of modeling. And here are some models for individual companies, much more maybe overfitted a bit. Okay, so here is some comment of on the choice of bases, which is very difficult problem. So we can do some sorting of the coefficients and try to adding them and looking at the improvement of the model and stop when the model is no longer improving. But then this is a difficult question, how to choose the basis ideally. But no, not non-ideally is relatively simple. And here is this clustering. So what we could do, look at individual models. So the highest value is the log likelihood for individual model for each company. Then we try to cluster them pairwise. So the question is, how much likelihood we lose if we use a common model for these two companies? And so we here there were paired two companies with the smallest penalty for coupling them, and so on, getting this tree-like structure. So finally, for example, these two clusters I have shown before was this cluster and this cluster. So one had dependence, beta spread versus price, and the second didn't have. So this is some nice clustering of companies based on common dependence of beta spread from other parameters. Maybe there's something deeper there. Okay, here is another article. So the task here was to evaluate estimate credibility of tax forms. So for example, there are some data from this goose, this statistical body of Poland. This means so there were some 37,000 households and like 30 something parameters for each of household. For example, age of the head of the family. And the question is, what is the mean income per person? Okay, so if the we can see from this density model that for 50-year-old person, then there is a bit larger density for the lowest income per person. For the 30-year-old person, there is a bit larger for the highest density. And for the 70-year-old person, we can see that the median is likely, the extreme values are less likely. So If a 70 person, 70 year old person will declare some extreme value, then we can say that the credibility is lower of such tax form. So finally, based on this example, you would like to use all the variables, 30 something, I will show them in a moment, to predict the probability distribution of the income, and look if the real value is in the high value or small value of this probability distribution. If it's small, then there is lower credibility of such tax form. So maybe some additional verification is suggested. Here are such examples as predicted degree 4 polynomials. And so here is as just polynomial, here is after this calibration to not to go below zero. The real values are the vertical line. So we can see that usually they are high values. So one is the baseline. So that the green here is, I think, the lowest. Also, the least credible here is the green one. But sometimes can go very, very low, nearly zero. So the very low, nearly zero, are the least credible tax forms here, and maybe deserving some additional verification. So this model was degree 4 polynomial. Here is degree 1, degree 2, degree 4. Here is the after the calibration. Here is after going back to the original distribution. So here was for 0, 1 uniform distribution. Here was for the original between 0 and 5,000 what is per person per month. So then the gray line is the marginal distribution. So without any prediction, we should assume the gray line. But with the prediction, we have some deformed this gray line, which is the deformation is based on the remaining variables. Okay, so here is the model. So here is for first polynomial, this degree 1 polynomial, degree 2, degree 3, degree 4. So we can see that there are the variables, 30 something variables, the month, the source of income, how many persons in the family, education, age, voivodeship, so this geographical, and so on. So here is sex, I think. Okay, so and the question, so we can see that what is the contribution of each parameter to the expected value. So we can see that for example, for education has positive high education, the last bar here has positive contribution to expected value of income, what is quite intuitive. But here you can see that it has also positive contribution to variance of income. So higher, depending if you have higher education in computer science or in some linguistic or so there we can see what is the contribution not only to expected value but also to variance, to skewness, to kurtosis. And after that we have these four coefficients from this four linear regression. It generally could be improved to some, let's say, neural networks. And we combine them and we get this kind of degree 4 polynomial here. Degree 4, we calibrate it, we go back to the ordinary variable and we get predicted probability distribution based on these 30 something variables, which are both, here we have continuous variables. So for continuous variables, I use these polynomials to get features from them as these moments. For binary, we get one variable. For let's say a month, you have 12, but minus one because they have normalized, so we have 11 variables here, 11 features for use in linear regression. This one hot encoding. Okay, so you can look how much value each coefficients brings up. So how much information in bits can we get from each variable? For example, for survey design, so because getting these values might cost. So here is such evaluation for, I call it relevance, that trying to predict based only on this one variable, how much bits of information we can get. And here is novelty, if removing this one variable from the entire set, how much bits of information we lose. So we can say we can have high relevance variables, but with low novelty. That means that it is strongly dependent, but this information is already in other variables. So the most valuable are the novel variables, which have some unique information, which is not available in the remaining variables. Okay, so as mentioned, so this is very nice. We have very good evaluation of value in bits, how many bits of information given variable brings us. So it's much better than for value prediction, because in value prediction you have linear regression and you add new variable, and if the linear regression improves or not, it's very difficult to evaluate it. But here we have real information theoretic evaluation in bits of information. So having these variables, adding this new variables, how many bits of information brings it for us. You could note what are the predicted mean value, expected value, and getting this kind of thoughts. Okay, so here is another article, recent article already published a few days ago for prediction of molecular properties. So some permeability, some half-life, protein plasma binding, solubility of molecules. So usually people try to predict what are the values of these properties, and I would like to improve it, extend it to predict entire probability distributions. So here is based on so-called fingerprints. It's Krekota. This is 4,860 fingerprints. So they say 0-1 fingerprints. We're saying, is the given group in this molecule or not? So you get this very long, nearly 5,000 features. And here I using linear regression. I would like to predict not just value, but the probability distribution by separately trying to predict this moment. So first moment, second moment, third moment, and so on. So here is the evaluation, how much information can we get about the moments. So the most information about the first moment, obviously, about second, and the higher, the more difficult to predict. So as the strength, I say how much the value divided by variance. So variance reduction. So after the prediction, how many times the variance was reduced, if having the prediction comparing to the predicting as the mean value. Okay, so what is the gain of this prediction of probability distribution? So here are such predictions. So you can see that sometimes there are narrow peaks after all this methodology. So, and I mean, it's a narrow peak, and the real value usually tends out also being in this peak. So having this, so just having predicted the value, we don't know how certain are we of this value. Maybe we are, maybe we are not. So here we have also this uncertainty. And so having this very narrow peaks, maybe if getting this narrow peak, maybe it's more certain that maybe the real value is indeed in this narrow peak. So here is such this kind of test that I look at values with some peak as peak. So I have this maximum, largest maximum, and and go to our left and right until it starts increasing. So the peak, this yellow peak, is from here to here. And I can look what is the probability inside the maximum peak as the integration, and what is the width of this peak. So difference between this right and left side, and the color here, blue or orange, says if the real value was indeed inside the peak. Yes. Yeah? So here it was. Yeah. So here the orange, yellow was in the peak, and it turns out that focusing on this narrow high probability peaks, these nice peaks, that we can see only the blue point. That means that indeed the real value was inside this peak. So for example, making this restriction, this selection, we get, let's say, 97% right. So having this selection to 6% of cases here, we have 97% probability that the real value was indeed inside this predicted range. So we are nearly certain of this property of this chemical molecule. So it is very nice for the virtual screening that we combinatorially generate some enormous number of molecules, and you would like to quickly choose from them the interesting molecules. So here we can throw out all the molecules we are not certain. So if there is wide distribution, then we are not certain. So let's throw out and just focus on these nice molecules for which we are nearly certain. So here is such evaluation. So focusing on so here is the okay. So here is the probability of the actual value being inside the peak. Here is selection percentage. So here we select 10%. So the selection, we throw out 90% of molecules. But if 97, 98 probabilities, the real value was indeed inside this small range we have predicted. So we can make this kind of selection. Also, we could make a selection of low or high values, and we can having so again, so here is the selection to 10%, and we can increase the quantile of value. So very, very low, very high values by this kind of selection for the virtual screening. So here is another recent paper. It didn't use this polynomial based methods, but showed another advantage of prediction of probability distribution. So it is for optimization of chemotherapy for cancer treatment. So it was so there is some public data, 500 drugs, 1,000 cell lines. And so now we would like to take a sample from a patient, a histopathology sample, and would like to test, let's say, 10 drugs, not 500, but just 10 drugs, some. So here is the number of drugs we are testing, from 1 to 20 here, from batch of drugs. And so the question is how to choose this batch of batch of drugs. So a naive choice would be taking, let's say, 10 best on average drugs. So this naive strategy would optimize the mean value among the batch of drugs to test. But we are not interested in mean of value of drugs, but we would like to finally use just one drug. So instead of optimizing the mean performance of drugs, the better would be optimizing the best drug in the batch. So this is extreme statistic optimization. So we don't want to optimize mean over the batch, but best over the batch. So the remaining of the batch are not interesting. You can throw them into the trash after, but just this one should be the best. So here is such evaluation for batch size in the horizontal line, and then the efficiency. So the lower the better. So the lower the better. So here is the best drug, the red line. And orange is the naive approach, as we take the drugs on average the best. And here is the optimized way that we optimize these extreme statistics. So it's more difficult, but we can see that it's much better, that it is converging to the best drug, but the orange one are much slower for converging. Okay, so we can see that we can improve the choice of this batch to draft to test, and why it is so. So here is some nice example of drugs. So it is 113 if sorted over the mean value. So it is not very interesting. It looks very non-interesting, but it turns out it is good to include it inside some batch, because if you look at the distribution, in 16% of cases, it is very, very, very good drug. Only in 84% of drugs, it's a poor drug. So if including it in drug, it might turn out to be the best drug. So this is difficult to show that this drug is interesting. We need to include entire probability distribution. In this paper, I use simpler model, just mixed Gaussian distributions. So instead of of this complex distribution. There are these two Gaussians. But finally, I would like to also use these polynomial-based models for better prediction of probability distribution in various ways. So there was some prediction. So here was a prediction of this this what is the so what is the size of this one Gaussian. So we have two Gaussians. The question is, what is the weight of one Gaussian, and the second have one minus this no weight probability. So the question is, what is the this probability, and we can predict it. Okay, so here is some other data for astronomical data to predict redshift of some active galactic nuclei. So for example, so again, people usually, there are many papers predicting a value of this redshift, but the question is, can we predict value? So here is exactly, let's look at this pivot energy. So we would like to predict the redshift and from pivot energy. So if the pivot energy is here, then we can see that the redshift is indeed localized in these lower values. Yes. So if the pivot energy is here, then the redshifts are localized in these values. But if the pivot energy is in the middle median, then there we can see that the redshift is nearly uniform. So we can see that it's much more sophisticated. It's not just it would be better to predict an high probability distribution, not just value here. So here is for using one variable, but finally you would like to use 20 something variables to predict the probability distribution. Okay, so here is some such model. So I used this canonical correlation analysis optimization to optimize the variables to predict and to use for the prediction. So it is a very nice technique to having two multivariate variables and to find the most correlated directions there. So to approximate the dependencies using some low dimensional variables. So it is very nice to optimize the features, both to reduce cost size of this model, but also for better regularization. And also we have some evaluation, what is the value in bits of this of information of various variables, finally some choice of variables. So for them, the violet one are the best to use. Okay, so another article published in this MNRAS, Monthly Notices of Royal Astronomical Society. So here was again for astronomical data for blazar. So there were like 500 length time series for each blazar from Planck satellite. So the question is, so here are the points after normalization. So if we project the points on this horizontal axis, then the distribution is nearly uniform. But we can see that there is non-stationarity, that the distribution evolves in time. So here is nearly uniform, but here is very non-uniform. It localizes in here, localizes here. So we need to some non-stationarity analysis here. So here I have used this estimation as average with this estimation as exponential moving average. So now I don't have just one density, but a density which evolves in time. So here every line is grayness is plot of predicted density as this polynomial. So here you can, for example, look at two parameters. So one is this eta, this adaptation rate. So how fast this model changes. And another is how well it localized. So here it well localized, here it poorly localized. So we have two quantitative parameters describing non-stationarity of these objects. So this is some nice classification. Maybe could be used for some classification, such as or some hidden internal dynamics of these objects. So for this data, I have used stable distribution for normalization. So the question is, so they have potentially heavy tail. For alpha equal to is Gaussian distribution, but for the lower alpha, it's heavy tail distribution, one over polynomial tails. For one, it's Cauchy distribution. So the question is what alpha should we choose? So you could just use maximum likelihood estimation. So here is something a bit better that I fix alpha and try to estimate the remaining parameters. So we can see that here for alpha equal 2, we have maximum likelihood. So here indeed we should use 2. It's Gaussian source. So after the logarithm here, so this log normal. So after logarithm value, we get nearly uniform distribution. Nearly Gaussian distribution, also Gaussian, and then we can start seeing that it shifts. It's no longer two, it's no longer Gaussian, but it shifts left, up down to 1,557,56. So clearly, this object from this, maybe from this object, we get below two. Maybe this. So there is suggestion that there is some heavy tail. So what does it mean? So using definition of log stable distribution, it suggests that there is some multiplicative process of infinite variance inside. So it's very, so the question is how to try to postulate mechanism for multiplicative process of infinite variance. Maybe I think this is nice motivation to search for models, what's happening inside these blazars. We don't really understand. Okay, so another type of analysis is this multi-feature autocorrelation. So autocorrelation analysis is relatively standard that we take a time series and we look at correlation inside the timing windows, values shifted by fixed lag, let's call it then lag. So having such 2 points shifted by lag 15, it is in weeks, 15 weeks, 30 weeks, 45, and so on. So here are the pairs shifted by this lag. So in standard autocorrelation analysis, we just say what is the correlation coefficient of depending on this lag. But here we can say much more. We can say what is the density for these points depending on the lag. We can describe them by various these coefficients, how they change with lag. So finally, we have this feature, multi-feature autocorrelation. So many features describing autocorrelation, different details of autocorrelation. They can be very, very complex, not just one autocorrelation, but there are many which can be different. And to optimize this basis, so here we can use huge basis, but we can optimize it with PCA, principal command analysis, to choose the direction in which this autocorrelation changes the most. So here is the direction where this autocorrelation changes the most. So with these two extreme values, or to here the lowest values, and you can see that with lag, so this depends on the lag, so we can see some oscillation. So it's some suggestion what's happening inside. So here is for this function from PCA, here is for another function. So we see we automatically find some a few hidden dependencies of correlation inside this autocorrelation inside this object. So I'm suggesting some hidden periodic process of these periods. So here are some such analysis for all these objects, blazars, suggestion of some hidden periodic process. So it would be next step could be trying to make some physical model and try to choose parameters such that it has similar autocorrelation functions. So all these three are for one object. So there are multiple hidden autocorrelation functions. Okay, so here is I think last paper in these slides also published. So there is some contagions in economy that how one market influences other markets. So we look at various markets, European, American, and so on, and we look not only how the correlation evolves between them. So it's called DCC, for example, standard methods, kind of evolving correlation between the two markets. But we look at multiple correlation, so not just correlation, but also some more complex, like dependence between moments which evolve in time. So here is PCA optimize some one type of correlation, second type, third time, and so on. So we can see that all of them has some kind of perpendicular behavior, and some large change can suggest that something is happening in the market. So here are some marked with color some events which were historically important. And indeed, looking at the coefficients, that these events are often seen by large change of one of these autocorrelations. So maybe it could be used that somebody looks at large changes of some of these autocorrelation tries to imply some events to act on. So here are some here we look for these events, how the coefficients change. So here is the first dot was just standard correlation, and here are eight, I think, eight types of these autocorrelations. So instead of standard, this is here standard, this is C, and here is 2, 4, 6, 7, 7. This multi feature evolving correlation between them, and here is a test if it has changed and how much it changed. So, and using them, it turns out that we have a bit better indication of something is happening than just using standard DCC, this standard correlation. So we can look at some dependencies between markets. Okay, so let me summarize. So usually people focus on prediction of value, but in fact, mathematics does not really allow prediction of value for continuous variables. Later, we say that it's center of, let's say, Gaussian distribution or Laplace, maybe. And what I'm doing is I can transform such prediction of value, can be neural network, some more sophisticated, some state of art prediction of value, into prediction of moments, 4 moments, 20 moments, and from them predict the probability distribution. So having prediction of value, you can transform, you can use it multiple times separately for all moments and getting prediction of probability density. But the big question is, does it bring some advantages over just prediction of value? So what are the advantages? First of all, mathematics says that it's not prediction of value, but right at the center of Gaussian. So one question is, how wide is this Gaussian Laplace distribution? So we have prediction control of uncertainty of the prediction. So we know, don't just know the value, but we know how certain are we of this value. And then for example, in data compression, we only need the probability distributions. It's because we translate it into bits per symbol in entropy coder. Often we have some multimodality. So it might be good to know that sometimes you have one maximum and then another maximum, and maybe it's good to know that there are two maximum. So if having two Gaussians, if we just say expected value, so we say in the center of between two Gaussians, so it makes no sense. This kind of prediction makes no sense, but then we should say that we have two Gaussians. So for multimodality prediction value makes a little sense often. And then we have a variable contribution evaluation. So we can evaluate how much information in bits brings this variable, having other variables. So we have the best information theoretic evaluation of information in new variables. Then we can do Monte Carlo. We can generate synthetic data using this model from very, very good agreement with the real data. We have some credibility evaluation, like in these tax forms, that we can say, we can show which objects have very low probability. So maybe there are less credible, maybe some outliers, maybe. And often these outliers are the most interesting objects. So pointing them can bring some value. Then we have non-stationarity analysis, that the probability distribution can evolve in time, and we can control it and also evaluate the speed of this change of time, and how well localized it is. Then you have asymmetric correlations, that not just correlation coefficient, but also this asymmetric 1-2 between expected value and variance and many more. So maybe maybe you could try to imply the causality direction. Then we have this excellent statistics optimization, like this bar selection for chemotherapy, that we are not interested in the mean optimization of mean over the of drugs over the batch, but of the best of drugs in the batch. So it's a very different problem, and the naive approach is usually far from optimal. Selection of extreme certain values. So for example, for virtual screening, that we would like to, we have a large number of objects, and you would like to choose from the nearly certain of known value, or nearly certain in very low, very high value, or in given range. Then we can do some euphemization in multiple dimensions. So not just normalization of one variable, but one multiple variable. Then we have some bias scenarios. So in bias scenarios, we could model the joint distribution and try to substitute some variables and have the conditional distribution for the remaining variables. The missing data, I've mentioned before. And this is the last slide. I would like, but it's difficult question to use this kind of model to build artificial neuron for something better than just this ANN, a very simple neuron. So the question is, having that simple neuron, what can a single neuron do? So it has some inputs, outputs. So the most it can do is it can build model of joint distribution of its inputs, outputs. And these models, these polynomials, are perfect for this prediction of modeling of joint distribution of these inputs, outputs. So we could update these coefficients and do prediction, for example, as conditional distribution. So having some inputs, let's say this red and red, and we would like to predict what is the conditional distribution based on these inputs of the remaining output values. So it could build models of joint distribution of its neighborhood and predict, let's say, conditional distribution. So I cannot imagine if more of single neuron can do, and such single neuron could already do a quite sophisticated task. But the big question is how to train deep neural networks, how to train the intermediate layers of such neural network. It's open question. Okay, thank you for attention.